Wi-Fi takes to the skies, Intel shows off a new classmate, and we've got a tech recap of the Olympics. All that news and more on this week's World Tech Update. Thanks for joining us this week on World Tech Update. I'm Nick Barber. We'll start this week with an update on a story we brought you last week. It's about those MIT students who prepared a presentation for DEF CON on the different ways to hack the MBTA subway system here in Boston. The MBTA got an injunction preventing the students from delivering their presentation, but earlier this week, a judge dissolved the gag order against the three students. The student's lawyer from the Electronic Frontier Foundation said that if the restraining order was upheld, the unprecedented ruling would render the scientific community reluctant to publicize research of benefit. The attorney for the MBTA praised the students, but still asked for a 5-month continuation of the restraining order, the amount of time the MBTA said it would need to fix the flaws. The MIT presentation is out regardless, because it was given to DEF CON attendees, and part of it was made public when the MBTA filed its original complaint. Another follow-up story we have for you is regarding some new search engines that are trying to unseat Google. We told you a few weeks ago about Cool. According to internet researcher Hitwise, Cool has less than 0.01% share of the search market in the US. Compare that with Google, which fields nearly 3/4 of all online search queries. Wikia Search, a highly anticipated search engine that debuted in January from Wikipedia's founder, holds less than 0.1% share of the search market. With the Olympics just days from concluding, many of the gold medal finishes and the games themselves wouldn't have been possible without a strong IT backbone. In Beijing is our own Stephen Schwankert, who's been following the games and the technology behind them. He joins me now by phone. Stephen, what's special or new about the technology at these games?
Well, Nick, this was billed as a high-tech Olympics, but actually it's high-tech is not really what we're seeing in terms of new technologies being deployed here. There is a limited 3G trial going on, courtesy of China Mobile and of Samsung, and there's a little bit of work going on with IPv6, but certainly nothing that anyone would notice. Really, the story here is that NBC is broadcasting all of its over 3,000 hours in high definition. This is the first time that the Olympics are being shot in high def. So really the experience both in China and outside of China is defined on whether or not you have high definition.
And how does that viewing experience in China differ from what the rest of the world is seeing?
Well, I would compare it this way. I think the experience in China is high enthusiasm, whereas the experience in the U.S. and in some other countries is high definition. High definition isn't you're seeing great penetration here in China because there are very few channels that offer it, and as such, the purchase of high-definition sets is certainly lagging other parts of the world, certainly the United States. So,
and in the end, who are the big technology winners and losers from the Olympics?
I would say all the big winners or losers are among the top sponsors that come from the technology sector. The winners, the medalists, I would say, would be not in necessarily gold, silver, or bronze, but Atos Origin, the systems integrator for the Olympics. Their goal at these games was to be invisible, and I think with 4 days left, it looks like they're going to accomplish that goal. And then that will then give them a great showcase for their services both in China and elsewhere afterwards. I think Lenovo and Samsung have both proven themselves on the hardware side and have certainly done a great deal of branding themselves in association with the games. And again, they'll be able to continue doing that after the games are over. I think the big losers have been China Mobile and China Netcom. Neither one really has a sexy consumer product to show off, even though they each have a huge consumer base. China Mobile is doing its 3G trial, but still doesn't have full 3G service available yet, and won't probably until the end of the year. And China Netcom, there's certainly been no bandwidth boost during the games. I don't think anyone will say that they had a good or bad experience with China Netcom. I don't think anyone even noticed them, and their booth at the Olympic Green was probably the least interesting of the various ones there. So winners are a Chinese hardware maker, a Korean hardware maker, a France-based service provider, but the two big losers are two very large Chinese networking enterprises.
All right, Stephen Schwankert in Beijing, thanks for coming on.
Thank you.
For those of you headed to the airport, we have a couple items of news for you. Those flying American Airlines between select cities will be able to surf the web at 30,000 feet. The world's largest airline installed technology from AirCell on 767s that fly between New York and San Francisco, New York and Los Angeles, and New York and Miami. After passing 10,000 feet and paying $13 for the service called GoGo, users can access the web, send emails, and log on to corporate VPNs, but can't use cell phones or VoIP services. American claims to be the first airline to bring in-flight internet to market. And the Transportation Security Administration is apparently trying to make travelers' lives just a bit easier. Starting this week, the TSA will let travelers keep laptops in their bags, provided they give X-ray screeners a clear image. These checkpoint-friendly bags either have to open in a butterfly or trifold style, so the laptop can lay flat and be seen from top to bottom as it passes through the scanner. Laptop sleeves are also acceptable. We have a few points for you in our news and brief this week. According to documents from the U.S. Federal Communications Commission, the first phone using Android will hit the market in November. The documents show that the FCC has approved the sale of HTC's Dream Phone, a device widely rumored to become the first to run Google's Linux-based Android software. Microsoft is under antitrust investigation in Taiwan. Launched earlier this week, the country's Fair Trade Commission is investigating whether Microsoft holds a monopoly over the island's software market, and if it abuses such a position. If found to have broken Taiwanese antitrust laws, Microsoft could face a fine of up to $800,000. Intel showed off a new Classmate PC this week at its developer forum in San Francisco. Classmate 3 is more like a tablet PC with a touchscreen interface and a display that can be swiveled. A stylus or finger can be used for data input on the screen. The unit features an 8.9-inch screen, Intel's Atom N270 processor running at 1.6 GHz, and an integrated camera that can rotate 180 degrees. The design is yet to be finalized, but will be in production by the end of this year. Well, that's our show for this week. Thanks for joining us here on World Tech Update. Next week, we'll be coming to you from IFA in Berlin. For those of you not familiar with the show, think CES in Europe. So be sure to tune in for all of the news. As we head out this week, we'll leave you with some more shots from Intel's Developer Forum. I'm Nick Barber, and for all of us here at the IDG News Service, thanks for watching, and we hope to see you next week from Berlin.